man has to earn his living by his own effort, and that there is no couple on earth, on any level of income, in any country, civilized or not, who would be able to support the number of children they would produce if they obeyed the encyclical to the letter. If we assume the richest couple and include time off for the periods of purity, it will still be true that the physical and psychological strain of their vocation would be so great that nothing much would be left of them, particularly of the mother, by the time they reach the age of 40. Consider the position of an average American couple. What would be their life if they succeeded in raising, say, 12 children by working from morning till night, by running a desperate race with the periodic trips to maternity wards, with rent bills, grocery bills, clothing bills, pediatricians' bills, strained vegetables bills, school book bills, measles, mumps, whooping cough, Christmas trees, movies, ice cream cones, summer camps, party dresses, dates, draft cards, hospitals, colleges, with every salary raise of the industrious, hardworking father mortgaged and swallowed before it is received. What would they have gained at the end of their life, except the hope that they might be able to pay their cemetery bills in advance? Now consider the position of the majority of mankind, who are barely able to subsist on a level of prehistorical poverty. No strain, no back-breaking effort of the Abel's most conscientious father can enable him properly to feed one child, let alone an open-end progression. The unspeakable misery of stunted, disease-eaten, chronically undernourished children who die in droves before the age of 10 is a matter of public record. Pope Paul VI, who closes his encyclical by mentioning his title as earthly representative of, quote, the God of holiness and mercy, unquote, cannot be ignorant of this fact, yet he is able to ignore them.